Anyway, we have another guest lined up, sitting backstage waiting for you here. So I think we'll just bring this young man on, Mick McNeil. Mick, are you there in Glasgow?
Hello, I'm Mick. I'm here, just outside Glasgow. Yeah, how you doing?
Did you like that, young man?
Thanks for inviting me on, Peter and Ross. That was really good, Wendy. Anna, Wendy. It was really nice listening to this stuff about South Uist, because I spent a lot of time in South Uist when I was a lad. I stayed with my granny up in Garnamoney. Great wee place.
Because your background was Barra, wasn't it?
It was probably Uist more than Barra. My dad was from Barra. My mum was from South Uist. They're both Gaelic speakers.
Okay.
But we'd a big family, and I think I was just shuttled out there to get out of the way, to be honest with you. I spent the time with my granny. I think my dad was at sea, and I think my mum just had too many wains to look at. She was like a nurse on the night shift, looking after 7 kids. I thought, better get one of these guys off to South Uist. So my early memories of life were in South Uist. Even when I started school, when I came back to Glasgow about the age of 6, I started school, and I always remember my Gaelic was better than my English.
Really?
I was always getting slagged off because of my accent and the way I spoke. I mean, that's all completely changed now, of course.
My goodness. I bet when you ended up in your simple mind years, the Gaelic came in really handy.
Just about as handy as a box. I had to laugh when you said yesterday, when we spoke yesterday, and you said about falling into the harbour with an accordion on us. I woke up this morning and I had an image of me jumping in a harbour with no clothes on, just wearing an accordion.
What a way to go.
An said flotation device.
Yeah.
Well, there was actually a fellow up here, Jimmy Butler, just did fall in the harbour with his accordion on, up in Shetland. He went to step onto this boat to play them a tune and missed his foot, and he went right down between the boat and the thing.
Oh, geez.
And they had quite a job getting him out because the accordion was pulling him down.
I'd imagine.
Well, do you know, please don't try this at home. Yes, well done, Cal. And he got up, you know, and apparently he just empties his accordion out, emptied the seawater out, and he still got it, and that accordion still plays. Now, how that survived, I don't know, but it did.
Yeah, that was the other thought I had. My whole image was me in there, naked with the accordion strapped on, and then all they pulled out was the accordion, and here it still... It still sounded great.
and then along comes the Waverley and crashes into
you.
Yeah,
that's right. That's right. You get paddled up round the paddle.
Round the paddle like a hamster for 3 days.
Oh, brilliant.
Brilliant. So anyway, yeah. So we're messing. So when did you start the accordion then? You started the accordion quite young?
Really young. I mean, my early memories of accordion music and old trad thing obviously wasn't used. It was my dear old Auntie Pat, who sadly passed away, took me up, and she used to have an old tape recorder, a reel-to-reel wee thing, and she said, these are accordion recordings on it. It was people like Tommy Darkey, you know, and I was always really impressed, but as much with the equipment as I was with what was coming out the sound. So she really got me hooked on this whole thing. I mean, I'm sitting here with loads of gear and an accordion. And I still feel the same way about my enthusiasm for both the accordion and the equipment. Do you know what I mean? It all stems from being really, really young and being in awe of what this dear auntie used to mess about with.
Yeah.
I never started until we got back. I think it was about 7 when my mum saw an advert, I think it's for Jimmy Blair School of Music, and she put me to go and get accordion lessons. I mean, at the time we were really, really poor, so...
Well, I suppose that got rid of you for another hour a week.
Well, it slowed me down because I had to carry that thing myself into the tune for Priest Hill. But we'd no money to buy an accordion, so she would actually just hire one off Jimmy. It was a great, great wee system.
Brilliant. And you ended up playing in Jimmy's orchestra and...
Yeah, I was kind of one of the early players. I was in the school when Gary was there, and probably when Gary started, actually.
Yeah.
And Malky was a drummer, and Yeah, there was a whole...
And of course it was Gary, we had Gary on about at the beginning of the year there, and it was when I was speaking to Gary one day, and that's how we kind of touched base for yourself, because he said about you playing the box at one point, and we thought, we're always really kind of looking for different stories on the show, to show people the versatility of the instruments and how trad instruments can get pushed in different directions. And,
one of the
things you were telling me the other day was how a lot of your ideas for writing stuff actually came in the accordion first.
Oh, definitely. I will hope to try and demonstrate what I mean by that in a wee minute, how the technique of playing the box really influenced my composition. Because, yeah. I mean, I came to keyboards much later after I'd learned to play the accordion. So I'd been going to the accordion from about the age of 7 or something up until I was in about second year in school. I mean, back then, we're talking in the mid-70s, it wasn't a cool instrument. It was pretty uncool. So I was always trying to keep it a secret. I mean, until foolishly, one of my wee duet partners in my Jimmy Blair class, his dad put us into a competition called Junior Showtime. Now, this is like one of the first ever, really at the same time as Opportunity Knox, way before your two time, before your time.
I can mind it.
Well, Junior Showtime was the under 16-year-old version of it. And we passed the audition and we never told Jimmy, we never told anybody. We just worked it. We weren't even sure what we were going to hear until you are going to Yorkshire Television next week. Have you got anything to wear? When you got anything to play? And we'd been doing some duets, and one of the tunes, because I obviously remember the tune, it was a German tune called what was the name again? It was a really crappy, it was a really naff wee tune. It was a really simple wee duet. So when Jimmy Blair found out about the tune we were going to do, he was like, oh my, you can't do that. He's freaking out because he's thinking, they're going to sound like, they're coming for the Jimmy Blair School of Music here and they're going to play that on the television. But we'd left it too late to sort of do anything else. That's what we'd done for the rehearsal. We'd all done it. So it cut a long story short, we ended up on the television, and I'm in first year at school, I'm 13. And them days it was only BBC and STV, so everybody saw this thing. And because we had no clothes, we had no kind of Scottish gear, they put us in these kilts with a big long bagpipe sporran, you know, the big hairy one?
The big hairy one.
The big hairy thing was way below our knees. We looked like a couple of wee tramps. And I'm really sad that I've never seen, I don't think the footage exists. I think they've wiped it. I'm kind of sad that they had, because it would be really funny to see it. But the end result was, when I went back to school in the following week after it was on the show, it was like, oh, there he is. That's the guy that was on the telly. And they were doing things like, you know, lifting the leg up and playing the accordion under the leg. as if I was some sort of acrobat. I'd been in the circus. So I was thinking, maybe fame isn't such a good idea. But here it did have its advantages. There was a serious interest from girls after that point. Oh, even though the guys thought you were a bit uncool because of the accordion, it was still, the girls started queuing up.
Perfect.
Are you
sure it wasn't that sporran?
They
maybe
thought it was a hole in
your
kit.
It was the spot.
Maybe they just thought I had a big hairy pair.
Oh, fantastic.
So the accordion, I got kind of burned with that. That burned me, and it really made me want to chuck it. And the only reason I didn't chuck it was because my mum had spent so much money on the lessons. So I'm going through first, second and third year, and by this point I'm in a band, I'm doing cabaret, and I was doing a whole load. I was in a dance band. It wasn't the Scottish Ceilidh stuff, it was more like the social club scene in Glasgow in the 70s was incredible. There was tons of working men's social clubs. So me and Donnie, you know Donnie, the Varsity Boys, Donnie, we had our own wee band during school, and we were playing like four nights a week on a Sunday afternoon, and we're still going to school on a Monday. poke his balls in with money, and that's only when they put a hat round. You know, the trousers are falling down because it's all money out the hat. And my pals in the class are having to sell our dinner ticket to keep up with us, you know, because we'd be dogging it on a Monday and then go and play snooker or go back, end up turning up in school on Wednesday, getting ready for the weekend. So there was a lot of advantages that were drawing me into saying, you better not chuck this, because if you stop playing this accordion, you're going to give up a whole lifestyle. And that frightened me a wee bit, because I didn't want to go down the normal road and get an apprenticeship and get a job. And even though I did do all that, I did get an apprenticeship and get a job. But the idea of just stopping music altogether was more terrifying than sticking out this bloody instrument that was dragging me down into the harbour.
Well, you said that to me yesterday or the day before when we were having a blether. You said about there's points in your life when you've just felt like it's, you know, you just want to throw it away, you know, and then at other points you're just like, oh, here it is, this is great, it's part of me.
Well, at that point, by the time I got up to my mid-teens, I thought, no, I need to get in a band that's like a real band and I've got stuff, and that's when I went out and got myself a synthesizer, which kind of did the same thing. I looked at the accordion in the same way as I would look at a synth, because at the couplers you could change it, you could really control the mood of the music that was coming out of it. More than I thought you could do with a piano. The piano just stuck to the same noise. Most instruments just they start with one noise, and that's it. That's all you get. Whereas the accordion gave me this option of changing couplers and changing the tone and just doing something a wee bit more kind of creative with it. You could imagine it was like a string section, or it was a solo clarinet, or it was, you know, you had all these options with the tones that you could get from it. So that kind of kept me. I could draw a parallel with a synthesizer with that. I got a synth, and the only reason I got in Simple Minds was because I was the only guy with a synth. So that was me in the band.
I was going to ask, how did that come about? How did you all meet then?
I was at the end of the point with Donnie. I'm like, I've had enough of it. Donnie and I were really going to kill each other. We used to do some clubs, and by the time the bingo came on, we'd be tearing into each other in the dressing room in a fist fight. Donnie was like, right, we're wearing the suits tonight, you know? I'm like, no, we're not. You know, he'd have these cabaret suits with braiding and all that, like, and all this stuff. And I'm like, no, I'm not wearing this suit. And he says, aye, we're getting more money if you put the suit on. And then in the middle of the gig, I'd be playing something like, I don't know, I remember Daniel, you know, the Elton John song. I used to do Daniel. I think I used to sing that one. I can't remember. I'm a terrible singer. Anyway, he'd shout over, we're doing the Drifters next, right? Just the Drifters. And I'm like, I hate the Drifters. We're not doing the Drifters. And he'd chuck a drumstick at me. I wear my Dana Drifters. So at the end, I'm like, I'm out of here. I'm chucking this.
And of course, Donnie's still playing. Donnie plays for the Battersea Boys. It's quite hilarious. Was any of the rest of the family musical, or was it the two of you, just Julia?
No, my mum kind of had everybody play something. It was the Osmonds. Except not quite as good. My sisters were guitar. My sister was in quite a good group, a three-part harmony group. And my other wee brother got a shot at piano. We're all kind of offered an option to look at music in a more, not professional way, but in a bit. She thought, my mum was really quite musical. She played the mouth organ and the jaw harp. Honestly, my mum would show up at a party and she'd have a handbag, and all this stuff would come out of a handbag that she could get a tune out of. No, if she didn't have a handbag, she'd get a tune out of the radiator. I'm not joking. But she was so self-taught, and she had that whole life that they did up in South Uist and Barrow, and back then where there was no TV, and they entertained themselves in a wee ceilidh in the house, and somebody would play the melodeon, and somebody would play the pipes. That was her whole life, and they were all self-taught. And she was determined to give everyone an opportunity to learn it properly. And I always remember how angry she would get if she ever saw like notation ripped or lying about, you know. She's such a respect for it.
Fantastic, and giving you all the opportunity, though.
Yeah, yeah. Donnie went to a drum guy called Lester Penman. He was quite a famous drummer in the 20s and 30s. He was a big band drummer. He used to do live black and white silent movies, you know, with an orchestra. And he taught, because I went to his drum lessons as well. In fact, he taught, I think he taught Malky Blair as well. And there was another band, I don't know if you remember a band that was in about Jimmy Blair's time, called The Young Set with Linda Thain. Do you know who Linda Thain is? It's one of Jimmy's pupils. They were really tipped for the top. Her drummer also went to this guy, Lester Penman, who was a great old drum teacher. But he taught, this is the interesting thing, he taught in the Gorbals, like three floors up, drums. You know what I mean? Like, how did he get away with that? And honestly, if you were next door, you couldn't hear the drums through the wall. They were so padded and so quiet. Yeah. And the technique was all proper, you know, with stick through there and tap. It was really, really... And some of the drummers he taught were like Marmalade. They were all quite... Although the whole famous drummers that he taught for Scotland.
Fantastic. Yeah. So you said the box when you were talking about that, weren't you? The composing and writing songs and things.
Aye.
Getting ideas for the box.
Yeah, well, that was only because I think that's all I knew. I never, when I picked up the keyboards and the synth, I could mess about with buttons and make a lot of noise, and it can take me down a road that I don't know where I'm going to end up, which I find quite interesting. One of the things I find in my later life just now is picking up the accordion or sitting down at the piano and knowing what I'm going to do. It kind of bores me a little bit. I'm not fired up with that anymore. So that's why I went on modular at the moment. I'll show you that modular in a minute on the camera, but it means you can just, you really don't know where you're going to go, but you're inspired by what you're listening to. And I quite like that for right now in my life anyway. But as far as composition went, I'll show you what I mean by the way I played the box, and I'll give you some examples of what the results were, if I actually do that.
Yeah, fantastic. That would be spot on.
Right, I'm going to put this other camera on so you can see it for you over there a wee bit better, and I'll put the light up. I'll put this over in this window over here. So I can see you.
We'll get that.
Oh, there it's there. Oh, there.
Mind you.
Is that better?
I was going to say, there's a thousand lights in that room and it's still dark.
Can you see that all right?
Yeah,
we can see you now. No bother. The Bersini.
Aye, that was another story. These guys were in Italy, and Jim, this was about 85 or something, and Jim came in to me and says, there's a couple of guys downstairs looking to talk to you. They look like the mafia. And I'm like, who's that? And I went down and there was these two wee guys there. They were impeccably dressed in Armani. And it turned out they were the Bersini brothers. And they were like, oh, how you doing? Hello, hello, hello. Like, and they had a box with them. And it was like, he opened this box up. And honestly, God, it was like full of jewellery. It looked like it was sparkles and some treasure chest with a keyboard buried under it. It was just an accordion that was covered in jewellery. It was absolutely amazing. I'm thinking, are they going to give that to me? I'm like, yes, please. But they say, no, we want to make you an accordion if you want. We saw, because they saw Belfast Child that had been in the charts or something at the time, and I was using a bit of accordion in the live set. We used to do a wee trad set in the middle of it, and we're kind of big rock thing, suddenly break all down, and the three was there with an acoustic guitar and an accordion, and it really worked in a big stadium setting.
But, and that's a fantastic thing when you're talking about doing that, because like when we had Anna Wendy on there earlier on, I don't know if you heard her saying, one of the groups she was in was a kind of acoustic, like guitar, fiddle, etc., and very portable, easy to tour.
Aye.
So something like that would have been, but the other bits of Simple Minds probably wasn't that easy to tour.
No, well, it was like this. It was just a bunch of technology, which was another reason why, it frightens me when it all breaks, and that was always a an issue that with anxiety before a show. It wasn't today we I'm walking out to 100,000 people or anything like that. That didn't scare me at all. What scared me was the things not working. Mm. Or all the synths back then, those old synths, they would go out of tune with each other. There was a lot of work to keep it sounding the way you want it to sound. So it was all about the sound. If it sounded rubbish, as far as I was concerned, I'd failed. It didn't matter how well I played or not. It was all about the sound for me, and it still sort of is. But this box, it was kind of my idea to get a load of metal on it. I'll show you a wee bit close up here.
Yeah, I noticed you had a hell metal silver front on it.
You can see that it did have metal couplers, and it cut metal ones in the space as well. And they got back in touch a couple of years ago. I know Giancarlo died a couple of years ago, but they got back in touch and asked how I was getting on with the box, if they wanted to send it over and they'll service it and do something with it. And I sent it back to them. And when they got it back, they'd completely redone it. They put a new grill on it and turned it into a really ordinary accordion with a whole new set of reeds on it. And I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all. Right. And I got back in touch and said, what happened to all the stuff? Where's my accordion? And we thought you would like this. It's a new model. It's a new, so it's all mother of pearl. It looks like something Gary Innes would buy. Kind of. I'm like, that's a girl's box. I want that. What's all the metal work? I want something that looks a bit more masculine. And he said, we threw it all. It's in a skip. I'm like, no, you better get that back. I want it back. So I sent the accordion back to them, and all they could retrieve was the front grill, and that was it. They put other bits and other couplers on it. To me, they kind of ruined it a lot. But I mean, it still sounds great, but they did kind of do a bad number on it. I'm going to get tangled in this. Where's that bloody headphone going? Right. I've strapped into the strap. That's the other thing. I'm going to end up choking myself in the harbour, naked with the accordion on it.
With the headphones.
Yeah. Right, so the first thing I'm going to look at that I think influenced one of the Simple Minds, a really big hit, was a track called New Gold Dream. And you'll know, Peter, how you do those things where you get, like, playing multiple fingers on the same note. No.
Yeah.
You know when you do that? Oh, that one. You know that when you go on?
Yep.
Well, I did this thing. It's going as part of the main melody for the tune.
Yeah.
So, I'll put it along with that. I need to turn it down. Idea, and you'll hear it in the tune when I play it along here.
Thank you.
That's the key. You see where that came from, couldn't you?
Yeah.
That's
Paddy's leather breeches in there.
Aye, exactly. That's exactly it. And the other thing was a kind of, it's like a bagpipe, peeprock type thing that I was used to do. See, one thing I liked about the accordion as well, and another thing that I don't like about it, is I've never found an accordion that when you hold the bass and the balance between the two is right, it's always too loud. A lot of the stuff I do, I'll hold the bass chords down like that all the time and then play along with it. And the balance is, it's always just too loud. But when you've got a mic and you can control the position where you're going to hold it, you can get away with that, which is what I would do with this. So this was like a pipe thing. And again, I hold the same note, the root note down. So I just don't change the root note. So that kind of lends it more to like a sort of the way you would play a bagpipe.
Yeah. Like a drone, nearly.
Just like the drone running along with it. So that was, this is where this came from. This kind of same introduction thing. What I mean?
Yeah.
That kind of lent, as soon as that came in for the whole, that's what we used for the verses of that, and it really just started with that kind of idea. I think that's a great chord as well. You think that sounds like, that sounds rubbish when you hear it out of context. Right, so I'll just play a wee bit along with the chorus to get a vibe with the chords of this, because the chords are great.
Magic.
YouTube for breaking the copyright laws.
That's absolutely, it brings back so many memories, so many memories. And does that, did that build from that chord structure, or was that something that, like, where did the, how far down the line did the lyrics come in that whole piece?
No, the lyrics came in really, really late. Like all the songs that we wrote, well, that I wrote with the band, I never heard the lyric pretty much till I'd finished all my parts.
Good.
Jim would sit with these tracks for almost to the end of the record, and we're like, well, Nate, what's he going to do? And once you build the track up, we're like, it starts to get really good, and you get really used to listening to it with no lyrics. So you start to hear it as an instrumental, and a lot of the songs that, a lot of the tunes that we did ended up instrumentals because we just never came with lyrics on it. But no, he done a great job on that.
I noticed we've got a pal of the show there, Mark Crawford, has put a comment in here. It's quite funny. He said, Mark plays the Shand Marino, the three row button box, like Jimmy Shand job.
Yeah.
But he's put in there, Belfast Child's Noise with the box, several lines. Little bit. There's a cue.
Well, it is a cue, because again, the exact same verse that you've heard there, I did the same with Belfast Child, which is hard the bass note, except this is in the D, this one. See that? Well, the bass just stays in the same thing all the time.
And then, see the other thing with Belfast Child, you done a version with that with the Glasgow Police Pipe Band, didn't you, as well?
I did. We did a kind of techie version of it.
That was stunning as well. Yeah,
no, that was another one of those anxiety nights where, because I'd run some stuff off the computer and I was just playing along with it, and the pipe had three different options on pitch because I didn't know because with live pipes coming in with it, and I kind of retune when I started, so I had to make a decision where we were with the temperature at the night as to which version of backing track I was going to put up to play along with it. It was really hairy, but no, it turned out great.
Yeah,
I love Duncan to bits, man. He's one of my best pals, Duncan Nicholson, and we've done a few things together, and no, he's great. In fact, the last time I played this was with Duncan, and we played the Trevor Horn Band doing a wee mini tour. So Duncan played also on a track that I did years ago, Rhythm of My Heart, the Roy Stewart track.
Yeah.
In fact, I'll see that rhythm on my hand. Have you got time for this? Listen to this sound of that, right? Because it was on this box, and the only difference is it has got different reeds on it, but it's the exact same. Listen, when I played it to Trevor, he's like, well, that sounds just like the record. So I go. You can tell it's the same box, can't you?
Yeah.
That's obviously the record. But it still sounds the way. For the rhythm of my heart. The rhythm of my drum. So let me just do this last bit with Belfast Child bit. So, I was just talking about how the root, but the deed, no changing at all. And changing the chords. Obviously, we took Belfast Child from she's coming, she moves through the fair. You probably know that.
Yeah.
I'll just turn that down a bit so I can play that. A bit of echo on it. Yeah, the bass is too loud. Pull that away.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Magic. Fantastic. Very emotional.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Very emotional, that. Fantastic.
Thanks very much. Have you had enough?
Not at all.
Can I take the thing off now before I drown?
I can go off. If you have another idea, you can fire it back on. Sorry. I was saying to you earlier, my wife Karen, driving it through by, but Karen was, her and Grace, my wee lass, she's six, she was watching you last night playing, and
right.
Simple Minds is now her new favourite, so AC/DC has been shelved.
Excellent, because you can't get them young enough these days, as they say, eh? You need to get the next generation of fans in there.
You mentioned Trevor Horn. And a couple of pieces that you did with him. You never mentioned some of the other pieces, but how different was that to go into that environment and play that way?
What was that, Ross?
With Trevor, you mentioned Trevor Horn.
Yeah.
How different was that to the kind of... You talked about anxiety with instruments or whatever, but that was... You were going into an orchestral piece there, was
absolutely
that?
No, that you're dead right. Because I had no technology, I just did that with the... Oh, shit.
You sure
not? I just did the stuff with just the accordion and Duncan, you know, and it was totally stress-free. It was absolutely brilliant. I really, really loved it. The only thing was, you're still relying on in ears and with click tracks. I mean, they had an orchestra and it was a 20-piece band, so it was all clicked up with in-ear counting, so you'd hear your cues coming in. So, and if the sound guy, he was under extreme pressure because he had 20 separate mixes to deal with everybody. And he never really done a good job with me. I hate to say it. My in-ear, all I had was a raging click dead loud in my ear. So you don't really get the same vibes that everybody's enjoying. You've just got to look like you're kind of enjoying it, you know. Like you're imagining it sounding really good.
Yeah. I mean, doing a broadcast once for BBC or something in Edinburgh, and the monitors were feeding back on the stage for most of the broadcast, but the folk up front couldn't hear that, but we had just to live it. We had just to get on with it.
It's horrible, isn't it? You're doing
that. But it doesn't make you play well because you're trying to think, is there any way I can fix this at all or anything?
You're trying to cue something, especially when you're strapped up. Once that's you. You know, even the headphones in the wrong position, you can't stop. You can't start on taking it all off again. It's a total shackle up. It's like a straight jacket.
it's quite hard sometimes to get. And accordions are a wee bit echo things to mic sometimes as well.
That's true. I mean, that's with that one. They had MIDI in that. It was the very first MIDI, and it was okay. It was all wee springs on it and stuff. That ultimately I got it replaced with a magnet system.
Yeah, the mic.
And that's still in it. I've had two MIDI systems put in that accordion since then.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't really use anything apart from putting a bass on it or something. They try to replicate a right hand and everything. It just doesn't work for me.
Did you like being on the road playing, or were you not that bothered about it? Would you rather have sat and recorded stuff?
I did prefer studio stuff. I did prefer seeing a creation and getting it onto vinyl. God, that's how long ago this was. I really loved this whole studio aspect of how you can control everything and make it sound exactly the way you want it. And ultimately up to the point, I mean, I did 10 albums with Simple Minds, and the last one, Street Fighting Years, which has got Belfast on it, it has a more traditional feel to it. It really felt like it had got me to the point at which I don't know what else to do. I didn't really want to carry on being like a rock band, and I was never really into a rock band anyway. That wasn't the reason why I did it. I wasn't into trad that much either. I sound really like I'm a boring guy. I've kind of stumbled along with whatever way the river flows all my life, and it's kind of served me really, really well. Yeah, I've never had to fight against the tide for it to get to go in any way. It's just kind of, I don't know, I think I'm really blessed with something better than intelligence.
As you've stumbled on from the hairy kilts in Yorkshire, you have been on some major stages across the world and at home.
Oh, aye. But I mean, hairy stages are in Pollock Shields and the Garbles. That's a hairy stage. if you're talking about Sao Paulo or Brazil or something like that, they're no hairy. The hairy ones are close wee clubs where they're right in your face. You know, like I did some stuff with the Pretenders after I left Simple Minds, and we did some live dates, and Chrissy Hynde got me to learn all these songs. It was like 18 songs to learn for a sudden tour. She said, we can do dates, are you up for learning some stuff? And I was only working on a record. I agreed to it, but I really stumbled my way through about 18 songs to learn for this gig. And one of the songs is called It's a Thin Line Between Love and Hate. It's a beautiful, beautiful song with great harmonies and it's sounding amazing. But the intro is me solo playing this octaves in a piano. This wee simple ding, 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 ding. And I just couldn't get this thing. And on the night, we're in a theatre in London. It was like Drury Lane or something. It was a kind of tight wee theatre. And I made a complete arse of it, man. And somebody at the front started laughing, right? And she turned around and goes to the guy in the audience, "Don't laugh." "I don't want him to laughing. You'll just put him off." And I'd already done a total roaster. Yeah.
Yeah.
So those are the hairy ones.
But how did you say it? I heard you saying that earlier on. It didn't bother you much going out in front of the 100,000 folk type thing? And...
No. I mean, we're so well rehearsed, you know. As far as playing went, the only thing that would go wrong with the actual performance bit would be, I did smoke a lot of dope and drink a lot back then, would be me forgetting, is this the second verse or are we into the bridge? What's right, coming in next? Did I just do the intro or was that the second verse? You know, that horror when, like, say, Alive and Kicking, for example, is going to come into that piano break. I'd be thinking, should I be going to a verse or am I going to the piano break? You know, that kind of horror and all these people, and then they're all going to turn around and look at you. all these images go in your head that seconds before you're going to blow it.
Yeah. But it's good. It's when you forget where you were the night before, that's when it's not.
Well, I've done that often enough.
It's not so easy to tell 100,000 people to stop laughing, I guess.
No, that's true, no.
This year we've not had much chance at all this year to play live anywhere, anybody.
Well, that's true. But, I mean, that's why this whole thing that you're doing just now, there's really, really got to look at that. And I'm into it because I want to make these people sound really good. Everybody that goes online, they've really got to up the game a wee bit. Because the internet is suddenly getting swamped with all these musicians just all want to play and they're not getting paid for it. And they're just giving it all away for nothing. And in the long term, it's going to have a really bad effect on music generally, because everybody's, I know they've expected it for nothing anyway already. You know, who buys a record anymore? Mm-hmm. But we're going to have to change the rules a wee bit. And I'm not in a musicians' union anymore. I was in a musicians' union for most of my life, and I left it a couple of years ago as a result of something else. But it's going to take something else like that to say, look, we're going to have to regulate people and getting stuff for nothing and expecting all these people, musicians, who've worked at it all their lives and built a craft, and you don't become good at an instrument in a couple of years. You take longer than a doctor would take to a surgeon would do 7 years. You know, you're learning this thing for 10 years at least.
The thing about it is as well, though, it's going to... Yeah, the technology's hopefully going to get better. You've helped us with tonight. You've got us the best sound we've ever had on this show, I think.
Oh, good. Well, thanks a lot.
By noticing some things to do, and there was some updates on the platform that we use. So maybe the platform's us going to start updating a wee bit, hopefully.
Yeah, I hope so.
Because it's been quite difficult for a wee while.
You're going to YouTube and you're going to Facebook. You're going to multiple platforms. But it's really this thing, the StreamYard, which is really like an engine.
Yeah,
that's the problem. This one's working really well right now. I mean, it didn't work earlier. You cut out earlier because of my internet, I think.
Right.
You obviously didn't notice the cut out because my screens just went blank.
Yeah.
It happened last night. Remember, it same happened when we did the test last night. We weren't sure what it was. Well, I think it was my internet. I think all my kids are on something right now. They're all watching. They're all on the internet. Maybe that's
watching Tartan Tunes, Mick.
They're watching you. Hey, Alan Henderson. Anna Wendy spoke about. Do you know Alan over?
I do know Alan. In fact, I saw Alan the last time I was in Uist. I was up at Old Norman's funeral.
Great lad. Well, he was fantastic. He was up in his loft doing the show with us, and he had to go away and chase the kids after the internet.
Well, that's exactly what I did when halfway through. Then I ran in there. He's going to switch some of these devices off. No, Alan. Alan's amazing, isn't he? He's a really funny guy. Oh, I totally love Alan. Brilliant.
Yeah, he's brilliant. Yeah. So have you got any projects in the motion the new there?
Local things. I was involved, I think, for Bannockburn, actually, the 700-year anniversary of the Declaration of Arbroath and all that. You know, that was a wee project I just finished. There's a rotunda up there. Have you ever been up to the rotunda in Bannockburn?
I haven't yet.
It's a really great site. They don't know for sure whether it's the site of the actual battle or not. They're assuming it is. And they put this, it's just a wooden structure with a Gaelic poem written around it. And me and another pal's done a soundtrack for it. So they've obviously got, there's no electricity there. We had to do it with wired little speakers that are self-powered and stuff like that. So the whole thing was quite tricky, but it sounds great. Duncan Nicholson and I made a bagpipe plug-in a couple of years ago. Now, it never got off the ground, really, various other for some reasons. But the samples are amazing, because we did all Macallan pipes, and I did groups of pipers of 3 and 9, and we did, of course, the full pipe, the Strathclyde Police Pipe Band, or Glasgow Police.
All right.
So you can hit a button going for a solo piper to a full pipe band, all in on a MIDI controller. And what I did with the music for that, I need to get an example of it. It's really cool. I took all the attack off the chanter notes, so the drones could come in and you could play chanter notes that faded in rather than going, a note is either on or off with the pipes. So I made it in such a way that I could just fade in these notes. They're all coming in and out in different tones and harmonies, and we've got it going around a circle in this rotunda. And for an old battle site kind of thing, it really captured the feel for it. I was really, really pleased with it. The problem was that the site people, the Bannockburn Centre, I think it's called, didn't apply to Stirling Council for permission to put these speaker brackets up. So they couldn't put the thing up. And I know what Stirling Council are like for planning department. It's forget it. Anyway, they said they're going to get it running by Easter.
All right. So that was something to look forward to. Once we get out of lockdown, we can go and have a look.
I'm doing some local stuff online. I'm really looking at trying to get my wee shedio here. This is a shed I built in my moved house at my studio. We only moved here just over a year ago, so I kind of sold everything and gave it all away.
So are you really kind of working with a band just now, or not really, just guesting and things?
No, I'm not working with any other kind of bands or stuff like that at this point, no.
So you're not going to do a reunion with Donnie and play Drifters hits again.
The Drifters. No. Funny, Donnie, the last time I spoke to Donnie, they haven't played since the last gig I did, because I did their sound as well live. We did the Blackpool Ballroom. It was really, really good. It was really an ambition of Donnie's all his life, was to be the band in the Blackpool Ballroom. Have you ever done that one, Robert Pippier?
Sorry?
Have you ever played there?
No.
It's the one where they come dancing is.
Ah,
you know that? So the Battersea Boys in Blackpool. It was something else. It was and that was the last time they actually played, which was in February. So I said to Donnie, you liking that? And he was feeling quite comfortable that it was, you know what I mean, he's not got all that pressure. He's just happy, I think, when he's wee house in Nask up in Barra.
Because the first time I met Donnie and that, he was playing with Gary Blair at the time. They did the duo as well, and they used to do a wee...
Were they in the ferry?
The first time I saw them was down in South Lanarkshire in an accordion club they were playing at, the two of them.
Oh, right.
It was good. Yeah,
good.
Brilliant. Listen, Mick, we were getting through about an hour again here. Ross, have you any quick questions you're wanting to charge in there before...
Not so much a question, but I think what you're talking about, February being the last of the live music, and just a kind of reflection on some of the stuff you said about things having to change for musicians. I really enjoyed what you said about your mother's respect for like manuscript and music, and making sure you guys had a musical kind of background, because 2020, although there was a huge lockdown and a lot of stuff that never got off the ground, it brought a lot of musicians from all over the world up to our surface. You know, it's made it might be a thing that's made the point very, very obvious that you can't, you've got to act in it now, I think, because of last year and what's going on, I think.
Yeah. Online, one of the biggest problems is somebody playing along with somebody else. I noticed earlier when we did the sound check, Anna Wendy was going to play along with me. And I'm wondering, have you ever done that? Have you ever jammed along with somebody on this?
No, not really, no. There's still too many delays and things and stuff going on.
But have you actually tried that to see what that delay's like?
I've done it with to a certain extent when I'm teaching in the schools, playing along with the pupil at home, and that tends to work not too bad. One to one, we're in real time, you know.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to get two or three people up on this and see if we can get them all to play at the same time.
Yeah,
we are a metronome source and see how it goes, because that's what we really need. Music's always been about collaboration and playing along with other people. Right now, you're on your own, you know, it's a kind of solo deal.
Yeah, you start to worry about forgetting how to play in a band, right?
So, yeah.
But there we go, I'm sure we'll manage. Anyway, listen, man, thank you much. Thanks so much for coming on tonight. Listen, you've gave up your Sunday. In fact, you've given up days helping us out here. And it's so, so appreciated. And thank you so much for giving up your time and coming on. And
no worries. Thanks for asking me. I really enjoyed it. Gave me an opportunity. Now I know about this StreamYard.com. I'm going to look at this much further.
Brilliant.
Thanks.
And if you ever need a pipe or a box player,
just give
us a shout. Or
I do know. Thanks. Nice to meet you, Ross.
Well, you don't need a box player. You're a box player yourself, anyway.
I don't know about that. I'm a bit flaky.
Absolutely fantastic to listen to tonight. Thanks a million.
Yeah, it's been an absolute pleasure.
I hope a lot of young people do end up watching this, because it's going to hopefully make that what you talked about the accordion being uncool a bit cooler.
More inspirational, Well, it is an inspirational instrument. I mean, they look great in the accordions. They look great, so it's a different world.
Even if they've come out of Skip from Italy.
That's right.
Oh, yeah, it has to be a piper's joke, that.
Well, as long as the next time you read about me, I'm no getting hauled out the harbour wearing only an accordion.
and the Waverley's disappeared into the distance.
Yeah. Okay.
No bother. Mick, thanks so much. Stay safe, man, and all the best to you and the family.
Right, thanks very much.
Thanks, man. Cheers. Bye. Well.
Amazing.
Hi. Kind of gobsmacked tonight. Just had great guests. And
great.
Hearing the different stories are two totally, completely different stories.
But both rich, very rich from Uist as well. So it's
And tailoring back to that traditional music.
Yeah, so.